First and foremost, I would like to thank Dr. VP Rao and the organizing committee for inviting me to present my work. And thank you, Honorable Chairperson, and thank you everyone present in-house. Well, we all know that breast cancer remains the second leading cause of cancer-related deaths in women. The most devastating aspect of breast cancer is the emergence of tumor cells to grow in the distant organs. Metastatic breast cancer, especially bone-disseminated breast cancer, is incurable. Metastasis is not only regulated by the intrinsic genetic changes in the tumor, but also by the host microenvironment. Several studies have shown that sites of chronic inflammation is associated with the establishment and growth of tumor cells. One such common inflammatory condition in humans is autoimmune arthritis, and we all know that both breast cancer and arthritis are prevalent in women, especially in postmenopausal women. There are epidemiologic studies showing that women with breast cancer and arthritis, their survival is lower as compared to women with only breast cancer. In spite of having this knowledge over the decades, it was never questioned whether, you know, like the sites of chronic inflammation associated with autoimmune arthritis are creating an environment which is attracting the tumor cells to home to these distant organs. We are the pioneers to study the relationship between breast cancer and arthritis. So we use two mouse models. The first model is the model of spontaneous arthritis induced with breast cancer, and the second model is a model of spontaneous breast cancer induced with arthritis, mimicking the condition in women when women, they have chronic arthritis and then they're challenged with breast cancer, and women who have breast cancer and later on they develop arthritis. I will try to focus first on the first model, which is a spontaneous model of arthritis. We call it the SKG mice. The name comes from the PI, the scientist who created this mice, Sakaguchi, from a laboratory in Japan. These SKG mice are on the Bulb-C background and carry a mutation of the gene encoding the SH2 domain of the ZAP70 protein. The ZAP70 mutation impairs the positive and negative selection of the T cells in the thymus, which leads to the thymic production of arthritogenic autoimmune CD4 T cells. Interestingly, in a pathogen-free condition, there is no sign of arthritis. So it needs a trigger, an infection. So here what we do is we inject the mice with zymosin A, which is a crude yeast cell wall extract, to induce arthritis in an already mutated model of mice which is prone to arthritis. Here. So first what we did, but this was my first study with a huge, we ordered the mice. I got two pairs of SKG mice from Japan and started to breed them and developed a huge colony of mice. When this mice, so my control, let me just point it. The control is the Bulb-C mice. My control is Bulb-C mice, which is the non-arthritic mice. And my arthritic model is known as the SKG mice. So this mice, when the mice were 2 months old, I injected them with zymosin A. And post 30 days of injection of zymosin A, around 95% of the mice developed like arthritic limbs in the forelimb, and the joints were swollen. At that point, I injected them in the mammary fat pad with 41 metastatic breast cancer cell line, which resembles the stage 4 breast cancer. And this is the condition, sorry. So here is what you see, the mice with arthritis and breast cancer. Interestingly, I would like to mention that in the SKG mice, which were, there was no injection of zymosin A, even when I injected them with 41 cells, they also started to develop show signs of arthritis, probably because that 41 cell is another infection for this SKG mice. Now, when we, after like 30 days post 41 cell injections, we dissected and did the endpoint. Endpoint means when we all open the mice, dissect the mice, and then we collect the organs and then process them. So our hypothesis was that we kind of knew that, okay, with arthritis, the bones will be, there'll be inflammation in the bones. So we were not expecting anything in the lungs. But to our, we were really shocked to see the lungs. You can see here, this is the control Bulb-C lung. This is the control SKG. SKG plus zymosin. This is the non-arthritic Bulb-C injected with 41 cells. And 30% of the mice developed lung lesions. And here is one of the mice which developed lesion. I'm showing that particular lung. And here, this was like SKG with 41, SKG zymosin plus 41. And you can see how bad the lesions were. So 100% of my mice developed like lung metastasis. So that was another, like, so then I thought, like, what can go wrong? Like, why are there so much lung metastasis? Then when I looked into the literature, I got to know that, you know, like, with arthritis, there's not only inflammation in the bones, there's inflammation in the lungs also. There are many inflammatory cells in the lungs. But what happens is these are not seen because the microscopic signs are only seen in the joints of the bones. So lungs are also, like, there are so much of inflammation in the lungs. So next, what we did was we tried to correlate, like, the arthritic mice which had severe inflammation of the lungs and the bones, whether the what was the state of their metastasis. And the state of metastasis was that even their metastasis was significantly higher. When we looked into the bone metastasis, so I did the imaging of these bones of the mice, but then these were graded blindly by Dr. Helen Gruber. We are collaborating in CMC in North Carolina. So here you see the metastasis of the bones in the mice injected with SKG41 or SKG zymosin and 41. So we saw significant increase in bone metastasis in arthritic versus non-arthritic mice. Now, when we go to the next model of the mouse, so the first model was model of spontaneous arthritis. Here, we looked into the model of spontaneous breast cancer where I induced with arthritis. So these are the PYVMT mouse. This carry the polyoma virus middle T antigen driven by the mouse mammary tumor virus, long terminal repeat promoter. So here we have like the PYVMT mice. We made it with the normal BLAC6 mice. And 50% of the mice carry the transgene PYVMT. From that 50%, 25% approximately turn out to be females. We do PCR to identify the transgene. To this mice, I injected with type 2 collagen, which emulsified in complete fluid adjuvant intradermally into the tail to induce arthritis. So here you see this is exactly how I also did the injection, though this is not the picture that I did. This I have taken from a paper, but this is exactly how we do the injections. So once So the mice were injected at 24 weeks old mice. When we did the endpoints, we opened the mice. And here also, we saw a similar trend of lung metastasis in the PYVMT mice induced with arthritis. So these are the mice, representation lungs of the mice induced with arthritis compared to the other BLAC6 or PYVMT at 9 and 18 weeks. So I just want to let you know, tell you this, that it's not that, you know, like PYVMT mice also develop lung metastasis. Even SKG mice, the control bulb C mice develop lung metastasis, bone metastasis. But here what I'm talking about is the incidence, you know, like the it grows very fast. And that is because we try to find out what is the reason why the incidence of metastasis is also higher, plus the incidence that it grows also very fast. I mean, it metastasizes faster. So here is the HNE staining of the lung lesions. Next, when we looked into the bone metastasis, there also we saw a significant increase in the bone metastasis in the arthritic versus non-arthritic mice. Now we knew, we established a link. Yes, definitely with an arthritic model, the statistically significant increase of metastasis was seen in both the models of mice. Now we wanted to know why this is happening. Here what you see is actually a nutshell of, like, it's a summary of all the experiments that I had to do to find out which were the pro-inflammatory cytokines and chemokines which were upregulated in this arthritic model. And Dr. Kapil Mehta just now mentioned, like, how important inflammation is. And then this is exactly what we found, that in the lungs and bones of this particular mice arthritic model, and even in circulation, the pro-inflammatory cytokines like IL-6, IL-17, TNF-alpha, VEGF, MCF-7 were significantly upregulated. And we also found, like, neutrophils and macrophages upregulated. I just want to mention that here I'm not showing all the pictures of my experiments, because if you look into the manuscripts, you will get in detail. This is just a summary because of the shortage of time. So now, based on this, we knew that, yeah, there were few cytokines. Like, I did a panel of many, many cytokines. From there, I identified that IL-17 was a cytokine, which is a pro-inflammatory, very critical cytokine, because it not only helps in the resorption of the bone, it not only helps in stimulating the progenitor cells like Rankl, then even like the COX-2-dependent pathway, but it also stimulates, it is also a very, it's upregulated even in a poor prognosis of breast cancer. So based on that, after we completed the first study where we confirmed that arthritis is definitely critical and it triggers metastasis in the breast cancer models, we went to the treatment pathway. So this was one of the routes that we chose, like where we targeted IL-17 for the reasons I just mentioned now. So when I replicated the same experiments, but this was a different study where there was a group of SKG mice, PYVMT mice, SKG mice induced with breast cancer, and PYVMT mice induced with arthritis. And we saw that there was a significant decrease in metastasis with the mice in the lung metastasis and in the bone metastasis in both the models of the mice treated with anti-IL-17A, which is like the inhibitor that we used. So this was a good news, but then we wanted to look, like, okay, like whether when treating the IL-17A, whether the downstream pathways are also downregulated or not. So here also, like after doing panel of cytokines, unfortunately, I found only two cytokines, IL-6 and MCF-7, which were downregulated with the anti-IL-17 treatment. And then one more interesting pathway that we chose was we knew that CXCR4 and STF1 or CXCL12, this is a very critical pathway with breast cancer metastasis. So I tried to understand whether this IL-17A, which is downregulating metastasis, if the pathway that is choosing is the CXCR4 and STF1 pathway. Now here you see that when we looked into the expression of CXCR4 on the 41 and PYVMT breast tumors with the anti-IL-17 treatment, I didn't see any difference in the level of CXCR4, which is the receptor, for the ligand, which is the CXCL12. But there was a significant decrease in the STF1 or CXCL12 in the bones, in the lungs and the bones of the arthritic mice treated with anti-IL-17A. And even like in the other model of mice, the PYVMT also, I saw a similar trend. This is the immunohistochemistry that I did of staining with STF1 in the bones, and here is the lungs. And we can see that there was a downregulation of STF1 level in the bones and the lungs. So from this study, and there are more detailed mechanistic studies in the manuscript written there, but we concluded that IL-17A can disrupt the critical interaction of CXCR4 with STF1 by significantly reducing the STF1 levels in the bones and lungs, and thus inhibiting the migration of the CXCR4 breast cancer cells towards the metastatic niches. Now, after this study was done, we tried to look into, like, you know, in 2008, 2009, mast cells also became a very important subject. So mast cell, like pro-inflammatory factors like IL-17, VEGF, PGE2, IL-6, MCF-7, and TNF-alpha, which are known to influence metastasis, are also produced by mast cells, which are activated by tumor-derived stem cell factor and its receptor c-kit. So then, And the other studies showed that mast cell infiltration and activation in tumors are mainly mediated by tumor-derived stem cell factor and its receptor c-kit, which is present on the mast cells. And the remodeling of the tumor microenvironment can actually be initiated by tumor cell-released SCF, and suggests that mast cells are not only a participator, but also a critical regulator in the tumor microenvironment. So based on this concept, we wrote a proposal, and I got funded from Department of Defense, because of which I could extend this hypothesis that was there in our mind. So first of all, we had to figure out whether the SCF expression was present on breast cancer cells or not. So this is the immunofluorescence staining on the 41 and the PYVMT cells showing expression of SCF on the breast cancer cells. Then the next step was, so what my theory was that, so these breast cancer cells were having, they were producing SCF, and the mast cells were having the c-kit receptor, so they are kind of forming a complex, and because of the complex, there's more upregulation of the oncogenic signaling, and also more formation of the mast cells. So now next step was to look into the muscle population in the bones and the lungs. So this is the toluidine staining, and here you can see that increased muscle infiltration was observed in the lungs and in the bones of the arthritic mice versus the non-arthritic bone and the lung. Next, what I wanted to check was if the differentiation of the muscles from the bone marrow, if there was a difference or there was a change in that also. So what I did was collected the bone marrow from the femur and cultured the bone marrow with IL-3 and SCF, and it took me like around 45 days or 2 months to actually generate muscles over here. So now this is, so I found that there was an increased differentiation of muscles from bone marrow derived hematopoietic precursors in arthritic versus non-arthritic mice with breast cancer. But how do we know these are actually muscles? Because when I looked under the high magnification microscope, definitely it looked like muscles, but we had to confirm it. So we did the toluidine staining again on these cells, and then also did the CD11 staining, which is the FACS. I did the FACS on them. CD117 stains the receptor, c-kit receptor on the mast cell. And that confirmed that, yes, the population, the differentiation of the bone marrow to mast cell was significantly higher in the arthritic model of mice. So this is the cell count. I don't want to go into this. But then once we confirmed that, yes, the mast cell population was upregulated in the bones and the lungs in the mice, in the arthritic model of mice, so we tried to target the c-kit receptor of the mast cell. So this was a route of treatment that we did. Also, like we also did the other route, like anti-SCF, but the results were not so promising. But when we did the anti-c-kit receptor treatment, we found that, so here what you see is the 41 cells which are transfected with the GFP, so that it glows. And then this is the GFP-positive breast cancer cells in lungs of mice with breast cancer and arthritis. And here you see there is a reduction in the GFP-positive breast cancer cells in the mice with breast cancer and arthritis treated with anti-c-kit receptor antibody. Similarly, we saw a downregulation of the bone metastasis in the breast cancer, arthritis, and anti-c-kit treated with anti-c-kit receptor antibody. So based on that, we could conclude that breast cancer metastasis significantly is increased with arthritis. There's higher mast cells in the arthritic tumor, lungs, bones versus non-arthritic mice with breast cancer. SCF-c-kit receptor signaling is one of the underlying causes of higher metastasis in the arthritic microenvironment. And interrupting the SCF-c-kit receptor signaling significantly reduces the breast cancer-associated bone and lung metastasis. So this work actually got the press release and was identified as new worthy in the AACR annual meeting in 2012. So I was very excited. You know, I got this award and all that. But then the next challenge started then. So after we thought, okay, then my next step was to look into the breast cancer patient sample with arthritis. So I kept calling all the repository in US, and I tried to find out. I tried to ask them, okay, I needed breast cancer sample so that I could look into the IL-17 population or the mast cell population in this patient sample, the real human patient, so that it could be translated to the clinics later on, targeting IL-17A, because we know that IL-17A is an FDA approved and is going through the clinical one phase trial. But the challenge started then when they said that they have plenty of breast tissue, stage 1, 2, 3, 4, but they have no data saying that this breast cancer patient samples were having arthritis or not. So that was a big drawback for the study. So then, so now really I'm looking for doctors, collaborators who would actually, who are clinicians, if they have, when the breast cancer patient comes, if they could also add a column saying that if they have arthritis or not. Because for me, targeting inflammation is the most critical factor, because inflammation can downregulate metastasis significantly. So, and as Dr. Kapil said, that that's very true, that, you know, like any non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, maybe a baby aspirin, that can also, you know, it can prevent. I may not say like cancer, you know, once it starts to spread, but at least, you know, it will be like the progression may be like delayed, so which is very important too. So that's my next step, you know, to examine the levels of IL-17 in clinical samples of human breast cancer, design therapy to block the IL-17A for metastatic breast cancer patients, and to examine the mast cell populations also in the clinical samples of human breast cancer, design therapy like to block the SCF-c-kit signaling pathway for metastatic breast cancer patients who also suffer from arthritis. So this was all my work with arthritis and breast cancer. Since I have just 1 minute, I don't want to go over, but this now, I also work with Oncotab, like UNC's spin-off company, where we are looking into the antibody TAB-004. But then here also, we are trying to find a screening pathway where if we be taking the human blood, women blood serum, if there's a protein called MUC1, if that can be detected, because that's upregulated in cancer. So this particular diagnostic we are trying to do, and I also did like around 368 sections of immunohistochemistry study of this particular antibody in different subtypes of breast cancer. But then my idea is that if something comes up good with this antibody, I would also like to try it in the breast cancer patient sample with arthritis, and if that's upregulated, then that can be targeted too. So my main goal is to target inflammation in breast cancer, arthritis, and in whatever way to spread spread this idea. This is my most important slide. Like, I would like to thank my PhD mentor, Dr. Sharbani Giri from Assam University. I would like to thank my mentor, postdoctoral mentor, Dr. Pinku Mukherjee, Dr. Sandra Gendler from Mayo Clinic, Dr. Helen Gruber, who is the collaborator to image the, who actually was grading the bones of the mice, and Mehnaz, then Jorge, Teresa, Lata, Jenny, who helped me during the endpoint days and helped me with a lot of stuff for the project. And they are our new lab members. And most important, my parents, Dr. C.S. Das and my mom, Rita Das, who's actually here to support me, and my kids and my husband, who he's taking care of them in Charlotte, and I could come here because of him, and my sister and her husband, who actually came from Mumbai to see me. Thank you very much. Thank you.